Hello students, today we are going to start with a topic, and the topic is CPU scheduling. So before we start, what is CPU scheduling, what are the various CPU scheduling algorithms, what are the basic criteria for selecting a particular CPU scheduling algorithm, we must know what is the need of CPU scheduling. In a single processor system, only one process can run at a time and other must wait until the CPU is free and can be rescheduled. The objective of multiprogramming is to have some process running at all times to maximize the CPU utilization. So whenever any IO operation requested or any interrupt occurs, then CPU must wait until the IO operation completes or an interrupt handled by the interrupt handler. During this time, the CPU is idle. So the CPU scheduler selects one of the available process from the ready queue and load in the memory, and CPU is given to this new process for the execution. This process of selecting one of the process from the ready queue and allocating CPU to this process for execution is known as CPU scheduling. So in multiprogramming environment, if we want to allow a CPU to sit idle, we will use a CPU scheduling. So we will discuss what is the need of CPU scheduling, CPU burst cycle, CPU scheduler, scheduling types and dispatcher. CPU IO burst cycle. So whenever a process executes, it consists of cycle of CPU execution and IO wait. So process alternates between these two states. We know that there are some process they are kept in the category of CPU bound processes, and another category is IO bound processes. So in the CPU bound processes, this type of processes all the time. This type of processes are do the computation rather than the IO operations, where the IO bound processes are those processes they do the IO operations rather than computation. So that we can say that a process is a sequence of CPU burst and IO burst cycle. A process migrates between these two states. In this diagram, we can see whenever process starts, initially it is a CPU bound, so the cycle is CPU burst. Later, when it requires some input output operation, it is a IO bound operations, IO burst. Then again, it do some computation, so again the CPU burst and so on. So we can say executing a process is a sequence of CPU bound and IO bound. CPU scheduler. We know that there are two types of scheduler mainly, long term and short term. Another type is medium term also. So the short term scheduler is also known as CPU scheduler. So whenever a CPU becomes idle, the operating system must select one of the process in the ready queue and start the execution. The selected process is selected by the scheduler. The ready queue is not necessarily the first in first out queue. The ready queue can be implemented using various techniques like first in first out list, priority queue and unsorted linked list. The record in the ready queue are generally process control block of each process. Scheduling times. CPU scheduling decision may take place under following four circumstances. The first circumstance is when a process switches from running state to the waiting state, for example, as a result of IO request or an invocation of wait for the termination of one of the child process. This is the first case. The second circumstance is when process switches from running to ready state. Generally, a process switches from ready to waiting state when any interrupt occurs. So, whenever any interrupt occurs, we have to handle that interrupt first, and then again we can restart the process. So, in that case, the process changes its state from ready to waiting. Whenever a process switches from the waiting state to the ready state, when, for example, whenever any I/O completes. The last circumstance is when a process terminates. So, among these four circumstances, the condition 1 and condition 4 are known as non-preemptive scheduling algorithms, where this, the condition 2 and 3 are solved with the help of primitive class of algorithms. So, let us discuss what is non-preemptive scheduling algorithms. It is also known as cooperative scheduling. So in this type of scheduling algorithms, once the CPU is allocated to the process, it keeps the CPU until either by terminating or by switching to the waiting state. The example of non-preemptive scheduling algorithms are FCFS, that is first in first out first serve algorithm, SJF non-preemptive, and priority CPU scheduling algorithm of non-preemptive type, where the preemptive scheduling algorithms are those algorithms in which CPU multiplex among various processes. The process switches from running to ready state when any interrupt occurs, and or a condition when the process switches from waiting to ready when any I/O event occurs. The preemptive scheduling algorithm incurs a cost associated with the access to the shared data. For example, while we have two processes, and one process is one process is updating the data, it is preempted so that the second process can run. The second process then tries to read the data which are in the inconsistent state. In such situation, we need new mechanisms to contribute coordinate access to the shared data. For example, the examples of preemptive scheduling algorithms are round robin, shortage of first preemptive, and priority preemptive type algorithm. The next component involved in the CPU scheduling function is the dispatcher. The dispatcher is a module that gives the control of CPU to the process selected by the short-term scheduler. That in this involves switching context. It's a situation when control transferred from one process to another process, switching to the user mode, and the last jump to the proper location in the user program to restart the program. You know that PCB of every process contains one field, that is the state where the process has left off. So whenever you again restart that process, the process must be started at the point where it has left off during the whenever it is last preempted by any process. There is a parameter that is attached to the dispatcher, that is dispatch latency. It is the time it takes from the, for the dispatcher to stop one process and start another process. Dispatch. Different scheduling algorithms have different properties, and the choice of the particular algorithm may favor one class of processor over another. Choosing which algorithm is used in a particular situation, we must consider the properties of various algorithms. There are various criteria that have been suggested for comparing CPU scheduling algorithms. The criteria includes CPU utilization, throughput, turnaround time, response time, and waiting time. Let us discuss what is the meaning of CPU utilization. We want to keep the CPU as busy as possible. Conceptually, the CPU utilization ranging from 0 to 100, but in the real system, it should range from 40% to 90% where for the lightly loaded system and heavily loaded system respectively. The second criteria is the throughput. So what is throughput? Total number of processes that complete the execution per time unit is called throughput. For long processes it may be one process per hour, and for the short transitions it may be 10 processes per second. The next criteria we want to discuss is the turnaround time. The turnaround time is a time that decides how long a CPU takes to execute any process. The interval from the time of submission of a process to the time of the completion is called the turnaround time. The turnaround time is the sum of the periods spent waiting to get into the memory, waiting in the ready queue, executing on the CPU and doing input-output operations. The next criteria is waiting time. The CPU scheduling algorithm does not affect the amount of time during which the process executing or doing I/O. It affects only the amount of time that the process spent waiting in the ready queue. So waiting time is the amount of time a process has been waiting in the ready queue. The next criteria is the response time. Another measure is the time from the submission of the request until the first response is produced. This measure is called response time. It is the time it takes to start responding, not the time it takes the output to the response. The turnaround time is generally limited by the speed of the output device. So, it is desirable to maximize the CPU utilization and maximize the throughput, and minimizing turnaround time, waiting time and response time. So if a algorithm having maximum CPU utilization and minimum waiting time, we can say it is a better than other. Scheduling algorithm. So these algorithms are used to decide which of the processes in the ready queue is to be allocated the CPU. There are various flavors of CPU scheduling algorithms. The first and simplest algorithm is first in first come CPU scheduling algorithm. It is a purely non-preemptive type algorithm. The next one is SJF, shortest show first CPU scheduling algorithm. There are two flavors of SJF algorithm, one is preemptive and another one is non-preemptive type of SJF CPU scheduling algorithm. The next one is priority CPU scheduling algorithm, in which a priority is assigned with every process and the selection of a process to be executed by the CPU is based on the priority. First, the priority is just like a fixed number given to every process. While the round robin CPU scheduling algorithm is a primitive type CPU scheduling algorithm, in which a fixed time quantum is given to every process and a process is allowed to execute within this fixed time quantum, and whenever a time quantum expires, the process is preempted. Let us discuss every algorithm one by one. So the first and simplest algorithm is the first come first serve CPU scheduling algorithm. As the name implies, a process that is requested the CPU first is allocated the CPU first, and so on. It is generally implemented using queue. All the processes in the ready queue are maintained, and whenever a process is requesting a CPU, the CPU is allocated. So once the CPU has been allocated to the process keeps the CPU until it releases the CPU, either by terminating or by requesting input-output operations. So whenever a process enters the system, first it is entered in the ready queue. Its PCB is linked onto the tail of the queue. When the CPU is free, it is allocated to the process at the head of the queue. But the disadvantage of this algorithm is it has long waiting time. Let us take an example of first substitution algorithm. Consider a set of processes P1, P2, and T3 that arise at zero time associated with the CPU burst time. So for the process P1, the burst time is 24 milliseconds, for P2 it is 3 milliseconds, and for P3 it is 3 milliseconds also. So whenever suppose the processes are arriving in the order P1, P2 and P3, so the Gantt chart can be created. So whenever P1 arrives first and it needs 24 milliseconds to execute, and it is requested first, so P1 will be allocated, the CPU will be allocated to the P1. It will start from the 0 milliseconds and it will end when it completes, and so at 24 milliseconds it will complete. As soon as the P1 completes its execution, P2 will get the CPU. So for P1 the waiting time is 0. It means whenever P1 requested, the CPU is allocated to the P1. But at the same time, P2 cannot be started until P1 executes. So the waiting time of P2 is 24 milliseconds. At 24 milliseconds, the P2 will start the execution and it needs 3 milliseconds to execute. So at 27 milliseconds, it will finish its execution. And as soon as P2 will finish its execution, P3 will get the CPU. Again, P3 cannot start until P2 executes, so the waiting time of P3 is 27 milliseconds. And at 27 milliseconds, it will start the execution and it will finish at 30, because P3 requires 3 milliseconds to execute. So we can calculate the average waiting time for P1, P2 and P3. We know that the waiting time of P1 is 0, because at that time only P1 was only the process. As soon as it requests, it gets the CPU, so 0 millisecond. For the P2 it is 24 and for P3 is 27. So average waiting time is sum of all the waiting time divided by 3. So average waiting time is 17 millisecond. The turnaround time of P1 is the burst time of P1, because as soon as P1 requests, it gets the CPU, so it is not waiting for any process to be complete before it starts. But the turnaround time of P2 is the burst time of P2 plus turnaround time of previous, or the waiting time of P2. So as soon as P1 finishes the execution, P2 can start. So the turnaround time of P2 is 3 plus 24, where 24 is the waiting time of P2 or turnaround time of previous process, that is P1. So 27 is the turnaround time of P2. Similarly, we can calculate the turnaround time of P3, which is the burst time of P3 plus either turnaround time of P2 or waiting time of P3, that is 3 plus 27, that is 30. So average turnaround time can be calculated by performing the sum of all this turnaround time divided by 3, because there are 3 processes in the system, such as it's 27. So this is the table that is comprising all the parameters P1, P2, P3 along with the burst time, that is 24 milliseconds, 3 milliseconds and 3, and the waiting time of every process 0, 24 and 27 respectively, and turnaround time, that is 24, 27 and 30 milliseconds respectively for P1, P2 and P3. But so if the process arrive in different order, and suppose the order is first P2 comes, then P3 and P1. So again we can make the Gantt chart of this arrangement. Initially P2 start at 0 milliseconds, because the turnaround time of P2 is 3 milliseconds. It will acquire the processor for 3 milliseconds, As soon as P2 finishes its execution, P3 will start, because after P2, P3 has requested for the CPU, it will start at 3 and it will finish at 6 milliseconds. So the waiting time of P2 is 0 and waiting time of P3 is 3 milliseconds. And at 6, it finishes its execution and now P1 has requested for the CPU. So CPU will be allocated to P1, process P1. It will start at 6 milliseconds and because the burst time of P1 is 27 milliseconds, the burst time of P1 is 24 milliseconds, so it will finish at 30 milliseconds. So waiting time for P1 is 6, waiting time of P2 is 0 and waiting time of P3 is 3. So I repeat, waiting time is 3 milliseconds. So this arrangement is better than the previous case. So in first come first serve, if we rearrange the order of execution of the process, we can have a better response and turnaround time or better waiting time. This is the second example. There are 5 processes ranging from P0, P1, P2, P3 and P4. The burst time of every process is given in milliseconds, like 350 milliseconds, 125 milliseconds and so on. So we can execute this set of processes with the CPU. So first P0 will execute, the waiting time of P0 is 0 and the burst time of P0 is the turnaround time of P0 is the burst time plus the waiting time. Because the waiting time is 0, so turnaround time is 350 plus 0, that is 350 milliseconds. As soon as P0 finishes execution, P1 can start. So P1 will start after waiting 350 milliseconds and the burst time is 125 milliseconds, so the turnaround time is 475 milliseconds. After that, after P1 finishes its execution, P2 can be start. So waiting time of P2 is 475 milliseconds and the burst time is 475 milliseconds. So 475 plus 475, that is 950 and so on. So using this table, we can easily calculate the waiting time and turnaround time of every process. But if we change the arrangement of arrival of these processes, we can have different average waiting time and average turnaround time. What are the advantages of first-come-first-served sequentialing algorithm? The first advantage is it's very easy to understand and easy to program, because a process that is requested first will be allocated to the CPU first. Is very fair process also. It requires only single queue to keep track of all the ready processes. But apart from this disadvantage, it has also some advantage. It has also some disadvantage. The first disadvantage is it does not perform well in the real system. It may be possible a process requires long burst time, and if CPU is allocated for a process for the long time of period, the other processes will not get the chance to be executed. There is a problem of FCFS in the time sharing system, where it is important to each user to get a share of the CPU at the regular intervals. It would be not fair to allow one process to keep the CPU for extended period. These are the disadvantages of first come first serve CPU scheduling algorithm. The next category of CPU scheduling algorithm is shortest job first CPU scheduling algorithm. So what are the characteristics of shortest job first CPU scheduling algorithm? In this algorithm, each process is associated with the length of next CPU burst time, and we use this CPU length to schedule the process with the shortest time. When a CPU is available, it is assigned to the process that has the smallest next CPU burst time. But there may be a case where two processes having the same CPU bus, next CPU bus time. In that case, we will use FCFS to break the time. It is also called shortest next CPU bus algorithm, or so, and shortest remaining time first CPU algorithm when it is preempted SGF. As I already told you, that there are two schemes of SGF. One is preemptive and another one is non-preemptive. The SGF is the optimal because it gives minimum average waiting time for a given set of processes. This is a simple example. Consider the following set of processes with the length of the CPU bus given in the milliseconds. Suppose the processes are P1, P2, P3 and P4 and the associated burst times are 6, 8, 7 and 3 milliseconds respectively. We have to calculate the waiting time and the turnaround time of every process. So, because we have 4 processes in the ready queue, we will compare the burst time of every process with each other. So by comparison, we can find out that P4 has the smallest burst time. So P4 will get executed. The waiting time of P4 is 0. And the turnaround time is the waiting time plus the burst time, that is 0 plus 3, that is 3 milliseconds. Now we will compare the remaining, the turnaround burst time of remaining processes. That are 6, 8 and 7 respectively for P1, P2 and P3. So we can easily find out that the smallest burst time is the burst time of process P1. So the P1 will get CPU. The waiting time of P1 is the turnaround time of previous process. As soon as P4 will finishes its execution, P1 will get the CPU. So the waiting time of P1 is 3 milliseconds and the turnaround time of P1, we can easily find out the waiting time of P1 is 3. At 3 milliseconds it will start the execution. It will get 6 milliseconds. It will get 6 milliseconds of CPU and it will finish the execution. So at 9 milliseconds it will finish and it will release the CPU. Now we will compare the burst time of remaining process, and the remaining processes are P2 and P3. So now we can get P3 has the smallest burst time, so now P3 will get the CPU. The waiting time of P3 is the turnaround time of previous process, the turnaround time of previous process. So turnaround time of previous process, the previous process is P1, so the 9 is the waiting time of P3, and turnaround time of P3 is the waiting time of P3 plus burst time, that is 7 plus 9, that is 16 milliseconds. Similarly, we calculate waiting time and turnaround time for P4. A Gantt chart can be created. At 0, P4 will start. For 3 milliseconds, it will execute, then P1 start because the burst time of P1 is 6. So it will start at 3 and it will finish at the 9. And so, and in the similar manner, we can create the Gantt chart. Calculating average turnaround time, that is turnaround time of P1 plus turnaround time of P2 take turnaround time of P4 divided by 4, that is 9 plus 24 plus 16 plus 3 then divided by 4, that is 13 milliseconds. Similarly, we can calculate the average waiting time of this arrangement, that is 7 milliseconds. If we were using the FCFS CPU scheduling algorithm, then the average waiting time would be 10.25. but in this case the average waiting time is 7 milliseconds. So by comparing the average waiting time of two algorithms for the same arrangement, we can say that it has better average waiting time. Another example of non-preemptive shortage show for CPU scheduling algorithm. Again, we have some set of processes P1, P2, P3, and P4. But this time we are also considering the arrival time of each process. In the previous arrangement, all the processes were requesting the CPU at the same time. But what we can say, the arrival time of every process was same. But in this case, every process having different arrival time along with their burst time. Using this table, we can analyze that initially only P1 was the process in the ready queue. So P1 will get the CPU. At 2 milliseconds, P2 is also requested for the CPU, but at that moment P1 process has been executed 2 milliseconds. So remaining burst time of P1 at that moment is 5 milliseconds, and at that time we will compare the remaining burst time of P1 and the burst time of P2, that is 5 and 4 respectively. So now we have a decision point whether to continue P1 or to switch from P1 to P2. Similarly, at 4 milliseconds, P3 also arrived in the system, and but the burst time of that P3 is 1 millisecond only. So at this moment also we can decide whether to preempt the previous one or allow P3 to execute or allocate the CPU to the P3 and so on. So initially P1 was a process. It started with the 0, it executed till 7, because whenever a process entered in the system, it was only the process. So at 2 we can decide, at 2 milliseconds we can decide whether to allow P1 to continue or switches from P1 to P2. So initially P1 will execute from 0 to 7, then P3 will get chance because the smallest burst time is 1. It will execute start at the 7 and end at the 8. Then we will compare the remaining burst time of P2 and P4. So both having the same burst time. So now at this moment we will break the time with the help of FCFS CPU scheduling algorithm. So P2 will first executed by the CPU and then we will execute the P4. So turnaround time, in this case we can turnaround time when the arrival time of the every process is also given, we can calculate the turnaround time is equal to burst time of process plus turnaround time of previous. Similarly, the waiting time of process can be calculated as turnaround time of previous process plus arrival time of current process. In this case, arrival time. So the burst time, and so P1 will get first, then P3, then P2, then P4. So turnaround time can be calculated as burst time of current process plus turnaround time of previous process. In case of P1, burst time of P1 is 7 milliseconds and turnaround time of previous process, there is no previous process in this case, so 7 plus 0 is equal to 7 milliseconds. After P1 we will execute P3. So in this case, turnaround time of previous process is a turnaround time of P1 for P3, and burst time of P3 is 1 millisecond. So we can easily calculate the turnaround time of P3 is equals to 1 that is burst time of P3 plus turnaround time of 3 days, that is turnaround time of P1, that is 7 milliseconds and 8 and so on. So using this formula we can calculate the turnaround time of every process. Similarly, waiting time can be calculated. Waiting time of a process is equal to turnaround time of previous process minus arrival time. So this is the calculation. Initially, waiting time of P1, because initially it was only the process. Turnaround time of previous, there was no previous process, so 0 minus arrival time, that is 0, that is 0. Waiting time. After that, P3 will get the chance. So turnaround time of previous, turnaround time of previous, that is 7 milliseconds. In this case, 7 minus, and arrival time of P3 is 4 milliseconds. So 7 minus 4, that is 3 milliseconds. We can easily calculate the average waiting time and average turnaround time. This is the example in which we are trying to solve the problem using preemptive shortage of first CPU Schrödinger algorithm. In this arrangement, processes are given with the arrival time and the burst time. Initially, let us see, initially P1 has arrived in the system at 0 milliseconds and the burst time is 7. At 2 milliseconds, P2 arrived. At 4 milliseconds, P3 arrived. And at 5 milliseconds, after the at 5 milliseconds, P4 has arrived in the system. P0 starts the execution. Till 2, it will execute. It means remaining time of P1 is 5 milliseconds. Now we have the option P1 and P2 are in the ready queue. We will compare the burst time of every process. In this case, the remaining burst time of P1 is 5 milliseconds and the burst time of P2 is 4 milliseconds. So now we will execute P2, that is 4 milliseconds. At 4 milliseconds execution time, P3 has also arrived. So till 4 milliseconds it will execute. 2 to 4 milliseconds P2 will get executed. Now we have again we have to make a decision whether to continue P2 or whether switches from P2 to P3 or P2 to P1. Till 4 P2 had executed 2 milliseconds, the remaining time of P2 is 2 milliseconds, remaining time of P1 is 5 milliseconds and the burst time of P3, that is newly arrived in the system, is 1 milliseconds. So we can easily decide the smallest burst time is burst time of P3, so P3 will execute. It has been finished because it requires only 1 milliseconds, so P3 has released the CPU. Again, we will decide at 5 milliseconds, P4 has also arrived and it has a burst time 4 milliseconds. Now we can decide among the 5 milliseconds of P1, 2 milliseconds of P2 and 4 milliseconds of P4. So the smallest burst time of is of P2 process, so P2 will execute at 5. It will finish the execution. Now we have a decision. We have to make a decision between the P1 and P4 and their respective remaining burst times are 5 and 4. So P4 will start at the 4 milliseconds and it will finish at the 11 milliseconds. And after that, P1 will start and it will end at 60 milliseconds. So average waiting time can be calculated for P1. Initially the waiting time is 0, but it is executed for 2 milliseconds. It is preempted at 2 milliseconds and it is restarted at 11 milliseconds. So the waiting time between these two points is 9 milliseconds. Similarly, P2 has started at 2 milliseconds. So initially it arrived at 2 milliseconds. As soon as it arrived in the system, it got the CPU. So at this moment, the waiting time of P2 is 0. Alright. At this time, it started at 2 milliseconds, finishes at 4 milliseconds. From 4 milliseconds to 5 milliseconds, it has to wait. So the total waiting time is 1 milliseconds. Similarly, for P3, it has arrived at the 4 milliseconds. And as soon as it has arrived, the CPU is assigned to P3. So waiting time is 0. For P4, it arrived at 5 milliseconds and started at 7 milliseconds. So the waiting time is 2 milliseconds. So the average waiting time is 3 milliseconds. So this is the calculation for turnaround time and waiting time of all the processes when the arrival time is given. So let us conclude our discussion. We started with the introduction of CPU scheduling. What is the need of CPU scheduling? Whenever in the multi-programming environment, whenever a processor is ideal, we can assign a process from the ready queue to the CPU so that we can maximize CPU utilization. Later we discuss what is the CPU bus and IO bus. We also discuss various topic like what is dispatcher, what is CPU scheduler. Then we start our discussion with what are the various criteria for selecting a particular CPU scheduling algorithms. Turnaround time, throughput, waiting time, response time. We also define all of these terms. Then we discuss what are the various algorithms that are available. This started from FCFS, SJF, priority and round robin. Then we discussed what are the various characteristics of FCFS, first come first serve CPU scheduling algorithm. We solve the program, we solve the problem of FCFS and we rearrange the same problem and we compare the results. Then we discuss what are the characteristics of shortest show first CPU scheduling algorithm. There are two versions of SJF, preemptive and non-preemptive. We solve the problem of preemptive and non-preemptive.